I want to talk to you just a little bit this morning about standing your ground. And something that, you know, having been a teacher, a middle school teacher for the last few years, some of the things that you reteach yourself as you teach middle schoolers always comes to play. And you know how God really, really has this whole thing wrapped up. You don't understand how anybody can believe in evolution when you actually know how the human body works, when you know how things work. And it's just amazing to me how God speaks to us through science and different things of that nature.
Amen.
But one of the things that I used to teach before my new position in sixth grade health was the glands. And one of them being the adrenal gland, the fight or flight. And that's what I want to talk to you about this morning. If you would turn to me, turn with me to Exodus 17. Forgive my messing with all this up here. Out of my comfort zone. A little bit. Exodus 17, 8 and 14, 8, starting at the 8th verse. Then came Amalek and fought with Israel in Rephidim. And Moses said unto Joshua, choose us out men, and go out and fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. So Joshua did as Moses had said to him, and fought with Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And it came to pass, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy, and they took a stone, and they put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands, the one on the one side, the one on the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. And Joseph and Joshua discomfited Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword.
Amen.
Now, I want to talk to you about a few different jobs that were listed in this fight, a few different positions. I had never quite looked at this before. We kind of always just look at it as helping one another. But there were several different positions that played out in this scenario. You had Joshua that had to go choose out men. And I love this because when Moses asked him to do it, he didn't question. He didn't say why. He didn't say, what's your plan? He said, okay.
Right.
He recognized his authority in the Lord. That's why this thing worked out so smoothly. God has already chosen you. That's why you're here. Joshua had to go choose out these men that would battle in this war against Amalek. God has already chosen you. If you're here, you're chosen.
Right.
No matter what you may think, no matter what Satan may tell you, he's already chosen you to be a part of his army. And to fight on his side. You may not have showed up to report yet, but you will. Moses' job was simply to put Joshua in place to do his job.
Right.
And to hold up the rod or the authority of God. Kind of reminds me like our pastor's job. He has been placed here to represent the rod or the authority of God.
Right.
To lead us into in this battle. I love it that when he started getting tired that they brought a rock and sat it up underneath him, because we know that Christ is the rock. This whole thing rests on Christ. But we each have a place. We each have a position to be filled. And if you're not in your position's left empty. Now, will God send somebody to fill it? Sure, he will. But will you be blessed having left your position? Be where you're supposed to be.
Right.
You're chosen.
Right.
You're chosen. Aaron and Hur's job was to go with Moses and assist him in the battle when Moses grew weary. That kind of reminds me of our praise and worship leader, our youth leader, our children's church leader, our Sunday school teachers, our pastor booster, our clerk and treasurer. Those are all people that have been chosen.
Right.
To uplift the leader. to come alongside him, because they're a little bit of seasoning on them, a little bit of maturity on them. And they know the game plan. They know how to work the strategy. They know how to uplift the leader. They know how to come alongside him and assist him.
Right.
And hold up his arms. You know, there's a point in your time where you cease being a sheep and become an armor bearer.
Right. That's right.
And then there were the men that were chosen to fight the battle. The soldiers, if you will. That would be you.
Amen. You.
Each and every one of you. If you don't fill one of these previous positions that we talked about. Sometimes we expect, or most of the time, we expect the pastor to fight for us. And he does. And he does that by holding up the word and the authority of God. But we forget, or we fail to understand, that we are in the battle with him to fight alongside him. In a different capacity, but with a job and a position and on the same team, all the same. You know, he says, if you've ever heard the pastor say, we're an instant family, just add you. That's true. We're an instant army.
That's right.
Just add you.
Right.
I need somebody to watch my back. I need somebody to watch my mouth.
Amen.
That wasn't me.
Just saying. Just saying. Because when I leave my back exposed, that's when my mouth gets me in trouble. We all have a place. Here's what I love about it, though. Here's what I love about it. We don't have to do the actual fighting.
That's right.
We don't have to do the actual fighting. All we have to do is stand still.
Right.
And know that he is God. Well, I think it's Psalms 46 and 10. Be still and know that I am God. Psalm 27, 20 and 7. Psalm 27. Real short, but very profound. One of my favorites. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
They are brought down and fallen. They, the chariots, the horses, the armies that come against you, the enemy that comes against you, they are brought down and fallen, but we are risen and stand upright.
Right.
Amen.
That's right.
All we have to do is stand there. Stand. Stand. There, now there's a law. I'm going to get a little, I think one of my favorite, those of you that know me, one of my favorite rights as Americans, and one that I think is in great, great danger, is the right to bear arms. You need to know.
I got guns.
Thank God.
That's why.
I want you on my side.
Amen. I got a couple.
Now there's a few laws, a few governmental laws, that we're going to talk about in the spirit this morning. And one is called, in the gun world, in the legal world, is called the duty to retreat. And that means if you are in danger, you first have a duty to flee instead of fight. I'm going to tell you, yes, it has been. We're going to get there. Don't get ahead of it. I'm going to tell you, quit running.
Right.
You do not have a duty to retreat.
Right.
You have a promise and a place.
That's
and
right.
Full authority to stand your ground.
Amen. Amen. That's right.
The duty to retreat has been replaced with the stand your ground. That means you have a right to stand and fight. You know, if you've ever heard Scott say, he likes to call it the men's conference. He does not like to call it the men's retreat. He said, as Christians, we should never retreat.
Amen.
Man's advance. Always on the move. Always on the battlefield. Always on the strategy. But sadly, we as Christians and church members, we've done more retreating than standing up to the enemy or even standing up and taking our place.
Right. That's right.
Okay. Satan's our foe today. Okay, Satan's our foe today. He's who we do battle with many times, and many times he comes in the form of your own self.
That's right.
In order to really fight against this, all you have to do is simply stand. Stand up for what is right. Stand up for what is true. And to know what we have been promised. What, you know, we used to sing it, standing on the promises. That's what that means. If you know what you know, you can stand in the face of any enemy and say,
come on.
Right.
Bring it.
That's right. Sure
bring
can.
It. Is that all you've got?
Come on, good.
I'm wasting my time out here with you. I'm wasting my time. Don't give in to the devices that he uses.
Right.
He will throw things at us like worry, fear, insecurity, warped perceptions, harmful emotions. Remember, stand your ground, stake a claim. No matter how it looks, was it Iwo Jima with the flag that they took and they planted the flag and they staked their claim and they said, we own this ground. Own your ground.
Right.
Own your ground. Turn to 2 Chronicles.
And
I know that that, even greater than him is the Lord God that walks through us, even through the valley of the shadow of death.
Amen.
Amen.
So I'm thinking, husband beside me, God above me and with me. Whom do I have to fear? Whom do I have to fear? Listen, the enemy has stolen things from you because you've given him the keys. The keys that he lost a long time ago. Carelessness. We're careless. I've got a family member. I think she's coming pretty soon, so I'm going to tell you who she is. Very close to me. Who had a bad part of her life. Got herself in some trouble. And got herself into the position. Got herself into her drug problem. And decided one night, when she was coked out, that she was going to take the Corvette in the parking lot that had the keys in it. And she did. And she got arrested for Grand Theft Auto. And my dad paid for a nice attorney. And the attorney got the Grand Theft Auto charge reduced to unlawful use of a vehicle because the man had left his keys in the car.
Wow.
And I thought, how often we want to accuse the devil of robbing us when we left the keys in the car.
Uh-huh. Ooh, that's good.
Okay. Mm. Satan's enjoying his, listen to me now, his unlawful use of you.
Mm.
He has no authority except what you hand him.
Right, that's right.
Take back your keys.
Yes.
Take them back.
Right.
Okay. Mm. Take them back. Now, we have all kinds of fight in us. The problem is, it's all the wrong kinds of fight.
Mm.
We fight for our rights, even if they're not our rights. Trust me, I'm the administrator of a school. You didn't have any right to take my phone in class when I was texting my girlfriend while she was teaching algebra, and I want you to graduate me. Well, what do you mean I didn't have a right to take your phone? You're 16 years old. You paid to be here. You go to public school for free. Go ahead.
Get out.
This is my school. This isn't your school. We let you come here. We do. We get this twisted ideal of what we or what is ours. Your happiness and your liberty isn't guarded by all the government documents. Your pursuit of happiness and liberty is protected, but you're not guaranteed to be handed anything that you don't go after.
That's exactly right. That's right.
We'll fight to get our way. That's my husband. I usually lose because he's never lost. We do. Our children will risk, depending on their age, getting their backsides tore up or their Xbox taken away or their car keys taken away by just getting their way to stay out an hour longer, regardless of what you say. We'll fight over the silliest things. We'll fight to win our side of the argument. For what? I'm not sure. I've never been given a trophy because I won an argument.
Hmm.
All I've ever been given is a sick feeling of, okay, I've won, but we're still not speaking. While we're attending all these fleshly fights, we left our joy unattended with keys in it.
Mm. That's good. That's right.
So the devil hasn't stolen anything from you. He's only got what you've given him.
Right. That's right.
1 Corinthians 16:13 says, watch ye, stand fast in the faith, quit you like men, and be strong. In other words, quit acting like a human. Quit yourselves like men. Quit excusing your flesh away. Quit fighting so that your flesh gets whatever it needs to make it feel good. Quit fighting the things that don't matter. Take your focus and energy to fight the things that do. I'll tell you what matters. The salvation of your lost children.
That's right.
The salvation of your spouses. The healing in the body of you or the people you love. Those are the things that matter. And those are the things that we are to stand in the gap and stand our ground for. And all it takes is an acknowledgement of the battle's not ours, but it's the Lord's. And I already know He wins.
Right.
But I'm going to show up and set myself.
Come on. Mm. Right.
Because you know what that does? You want to intimidate any enemy? Step up to his nose and go. He might start thinking maybe he said a little too much and maybe it's not something he wants to mess with. Enemies only bully scared people.
Right.
Who don't know what they're made of. We're so busy fighting for our rights, fighting for what we want, and fighting against one another, that the enemy has just come into our camp and taken whatever he wants right under our nose. Because we have left it unattended. Listen, the enemy can't break through a fortified line.
Mm-hmm.
Can't.
Right.
Can't. You know, if you ever watch any of the old war pictures and war shows, you would watch them advance, the infantry on the ground, and you would watch them advance, and they would have the whole front line, and in the front line, they would have the flag bearer. And listen, when the front line fell, there was a line right behind it. And wherever the flag fell, there was somebody right there to pick it up.
That's right.
You can't come against that. It's too strong.
Mm-hmm.
If we stand united and understand that we are soldiers that are designed and created to stand shoulder to shoulder, mm-hmm. to create a front line that the enemy cannot surpass.
That's right.
But when we're two like little siblings, your 2 and 3 year old, 4 and 5 year old in the back of the truck, the back of the car. My kids loved it when I got a Suburban because they could go further back without it. That's what happened. One time, Mom, could you pull over first? You're getting innocent ones.
I get that film. That's sweet.
Listen. The enemy cannot break through a fortified line, but we, like spoiled children with our siblings, are so busy poking one another and irritating and annoying one another that we're not even looking at the real enemy.
Right.
Come on.
Mm. Them kids never saw me coming. They were too busy poking one another. Blitz attack. One time, you know, nature testifies of Christ.
Yes.
And I remember one of the things in our early ministry, one of the things that spoke so greatly to Scott and I was that we were down at, we hadn't come to pastor yet, we were down at a member's house. We went to the Pinellas Church down at Pinellas Park. And we were out at a member's house, and we were outside, and there's a lot of wild parrots down that way. And they're beautiful. And Scott decided he was going to get him one of these parrots. And these birds were at the top of the tree, and they're 30, 40 feet up. And as he's standing and thinking, how in the world am I going to get up there and get one of those birds? They started bickering. And they were bickering at one another. And as they would bicker, They fell further and further down the tree. And they bickered, and they bickered. And they got right down to where he swooped up and got a hand on one. Never saw the enemy coming because they were so busy bickering with one another. They not only dropped right down into the enemy's camp, they didn't even know they had done it.
That's right.
Imagine if those two birds would have said, hey, you look pretty good up here. Yeah, you look pretty good too. You look pretty good together. Hey, I think we should fly around here a little bit and see how good we look. All they've been. You know, one of the things that, if you've ever watched dueling or fencing, so we call it fencing, is they'll say, on guard. On guard. I'm better at this than I am a smartphone. On guard. You know what that means? I stand ready.
That's right.
Not only to protect myself, but to attack. I stand ready. Now listen, there's another law on the Florida books for gun owners called the Castle Law. Mm-hmm. That means it's what's mine, I'm going to protect. It used to just be your house. Now it's your person. So I'm on the sidewalk, I'm going to protect what's mine. Me and all that little brood of hens or ducklings go with me. I'm going to stand my ground. Protecting what belongs to you. Listen, the Lord has already given us the land. He said, wherever we put our feet belongs to us.
Right. That's right.
That's what he said. So either he's a liar or he's not.
Come on.
Okay? If he's a God that cannot lie, then every word that comes out of his mouth must be true.
That's right.
So, everywhere that you put your foot, peace. Joy,
right.
Sound mind,
right.
Power, good health, your saved family, your unsaved family. They're yours for the taking.
Yes.
Yours for the taking. Turn to Joshua 18. Joshua 18, verses 2 and 3. And there remained among the children of Israel seven tribes, which had not yet received their inheritance. And Joshua said unto the children of Israel, how long are ye slack to go possess the land which the Lord God your Father hath given you? Mm. How long?
Right.
How long are you going to sit in your house and cry? How long are you going to sit around in church Sunday after Sunday after Sunday feeling defeated?
Right.
Possess your land.
Right.
Set yourself. Stand your ground. Protect what's yours.
Right.
Stand on the promises.
Yes.
Take your keys back.
Good.
We've got to lose the carelessness of shallow Christianity, self-pity, self-serving views, and half-committed lives, and prepare ourselves like soldiers armed for battle.
Amen.
They just don't pull 17 and 18 year old boys off the street and throw them in a foxhole somewhere. They prepare them. How pleasant was boot camp, John? Enjoy it, Tim.
That was awesome.
Good answer. Here's what we're going to do, son. We're going to take you. Mama, here's what we're going to do. We're going to take your daughter. She's not even going to be allowed to call and say what she wants to say to you when she arrives where she's at. She's going to be able to call. She's going to be given a sentence that's scripted on a piece of paper for her. She's going to say, I have arrived safely. Am I telling the truth? And guess what? Little baby that was shooting hoops in her backyard with some of her friends 2 days ago has now grown up. In Timothy, it says that we are to endure hardness like a good soldier. Mm-hmm. We're too soft. Mm-hmm. Oh, we're soft. Soft. I'm challenging you this morning. to live your life in spiritual boot camp. You know what that means? You're going to have to deny yourself a little bit. You're going to have to get up a little earlier. You're going to have to run a little harder.
Right.
You're going to have to deny yourself a little more. You're going to have to study more. You're going to have to pray more. You're going to have to fast more. And you're going to have to prepare yourself for battle. Fortify yourself. And remember that when you have done all you can do to stand.
Stand.
Keep on standing.
Right.
And you know what? If you're having trouble standing, don't be afraid to say, Amy, I need help. I'm getting tired. I'm getting weary. I need somebody to hold me up. I'm telling you, there have been times where your pastor and I would have been gone.
Right.
If it had not been for you. There are some of you that would have made us leave. And there are some of you that said, give them a little more time. I'll hold you up until they don't want to make you leave anymore. That's what it's about. That's what it's about. Refuse to back down in the face of the enemy and refuse to be sidetracked.
Amen.
Too much ADD going on in the church. Listen. Oh, Lord. I love you. Let me get that new banner. Oh, Lord, I need to pray. I'm going to shut this door and I'm going to pray. And ooh, this bedroom's a mess. I think I'm going to clean it up. We're too easily sidetracked about things that matter. We've got to learn to carve some time and set this. I know we're busy. I've been trying to figure out our phone for 3 days. I still don't know who all I've called.
Sure got Apple.
Okay? Kids, just fend for yourselves. I know it's supper time, 4 hours ago. Fend for yourself. I've got to figure out how to get this application off this phone. I know the things that matter are left to the wayside while the things that don't consume us.
Right.
Turn to Ephesians, and we will close with this. Very familiar passage of scripture to a lot of you. But one we fail to live by. Ephesians 6. See, I think part of our problem as Christians, whether we've been saved 2 months or 30 years, is we've not taken the time to read the manual. We've not taken the time to learn. I remember Scott said one of the things that he enjoyed the most in boot camp. Well, no, I'm not really, what was it, AR-15? I don't know what they had.
Yeah.
AR-15 military issue.
M-16?
That he had to break it down and put it back together in a certain amount of time. Less time than it takes you to microwave some Easy Mac. Bring it up. And you know what that was? Familiarity with your weapons. Because when you know that weapon inside and out, you are at advantage. Ephesians 6, 10 through 17. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore.
Yes. Amen. That's right.
Brother Johnny, if you would, come on.
Flesh.
Having your loins girt about with truth. Now listen, I'm going to tell you something here. I have somewhat ought against some versions of the different versions. Not that I'm against them all, but I have somewhat ought of the ones that change the loins to the waist. Because what we need to guard with truth, I don't mean to be offensive or crude, but listen to me for just a minute. The loins are the reproductive organs. Make sure that you are reproducing truth in your life.
Amen.
Having on the breastplate of righteousness and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. I want to challenge you this morning to enlist. I want to challenge you to stand up more in body, but in spirit. I want you to stand up and take your ground that is rightfully yours. Stand with me this morning. We're going to open up this altar. Listen, I'm not one of those people that can give a great grand altar call.